The transition to virtual or open RAN is part of the next evolution of telecom. So what product iterations are on the horizon, and what are the projected financial benefits? Here to discuss this and more is Matt Conrod, vRAN Global Business Development Director, Intel Sales and Marketing at Intel Corporation. Matt, thanks for being with us today. What is Intel's role in supporting and evolving the mobile broadband network, including RAN?
Thanks, Clarence. So historically, Intel was selling components, embedded components, into the equipment manufacturers, who would in turn sell their solutions to the operators. With the advent of NFV, Intel's role has changed dramatically. We have become a bit more of a trusted, fellow traveler or technology partner, and exposing, helping them to create a vision by exposing cloud technologies, and then helping them realize that vision through identification of best practices and, trade-offs, network trade-offs. This slide is an overview of where we're relevant in the Open RAN stack. We absolutely have components in every node in the ORAN specification, from OCU and ODU, where we typically see the x86 processor, our NIC family of PCIe cards, as well as in some instances we use FPGA and structured ASICs. In the ORU, we see more FPGAs and structured ASICs, but we don't stop there. Intel has been investing over the last 10 years in reference designs, both on the hardware side, as well as a reference software stack called FlexRAN that we use to help the RAN and OSV community, to determine how to get the best out of the underlying hardware. And then lastly, we're very active in standards and open source communities. We want to make sure that our APIs and instruction sets are open for all to use and leverage for their own implementation.
Now, Intel has been supporting the telecommunications industry for years. Why would a carrier want to deploy on x86 architecture?
Yeah, and for those that don't know me, I'm ex-Ericsson, ex-Nortel, longtime telecom RAN engineer and product manager and sales guy. And it took me about 2 weeks on the job at Intel to realize that we would be doing the telecom industry a disservice if we didn't expose them to cloud technologies. A few things that stood out, just the investment in silicon is disproportionate between industries, between, the silicon that's going into traditional RAN versus the silicon investment that's in x86 is disproportionate. The second thing is when you hardware software disaggregate, you can really drive flexibility in the software layer. And with flexibility comes innovation and improved pace of innovation. So it's easier to automate, scale, and then drive innovation like AI on a disaggregated platform. In addition to that, you get a better economy of scale with a COTS-based server. Multiple RAN vendors can use the same hardware. Also, you can drive different workloads or multiple workloads on the same hardware as well and get economies of scale. But I'm most encouraged by just the pace of innovation and software innovation that's coming from cloud. And what Intel will help the operator community do is pick those applicable technologies and help introduce them into the telco cloud network.
So how has Intel iterated its products to meet the needs of the industry?
Yeah, Intel is investing to set a torrid pace of innovation for virtual RAN. I like to call this slide the Moore's Law of vRAN. We are investing in better silicon instruction sets and accelerators to double RAN capacity per watt generation on generation. And as highlighting here, we're now on our third generation of commercial vRAN solution. We started with Ice Lake or the second generation Xeon with external acceleration on a FPGA card. FPGA cards are programmable, so they were flexible, but they weren't super power efficient and managing FPGA code, blurred the hardware software disaggregation lines. So we learned from that. After that, we went to a structured ASIC for the RAN accelerator, still in a PCIe form factor, but we needed all the PCIe slots for I/O, front haul connectivity, as well as, the system was still a little bit more complicated than what most global operators were looking for. So in our fourth generation of Xeon processor, we've integrated the FEC accelerator on die right in the CPU, shared cache, shared memory, low latency bus between the CPU and the acceleration components. And in doing so, we've not only simplified the solution, but we've driven additional power out of the system. We'll continue with this investment going forward. We're already planning for the fifth generation Xeon processor designed for or optimized for vRAN. A better CPU, more instruction sets, and more integration. But let me just go back to today's solution on this next slide. What we have here is what we came to market with earlier this year. We're already seeing operators with commercial solutions based on the fourth generation Xeon processor. But fantastic gains from capacity, as well as reduced power savings when we've integrated the FEC accelerator on die.
Matt, given the depth of your engagement in the industry, can you share your thoughts on the transition to virtual or Open RAN?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's been a few operators that have gone through this journey from traditional to virtualized RAN. And I guess there is good news for those that are to follow. There are some best practices on the market. Verizon's journey is actually quite public. All of these references have been disclosed in the public domain, but this journey started back in 2018 when Verizon first introduced virtualized CU and virtualized CU into their network through trials. And the focus initially was to reach KPI parity between traditional RAN and virtualized RAN. I'd be happy to say we've seen it at Verizon and Vodafone UK, amongst other places in the world, but the compute is ready. The solution is ready to match or exceed KPIs between virtualized RAN and traditional RAN. After you meet KPIs or figure out how to deploy your first system, then the focus went to scale. Verizon then spent about 2 years scaling from hundreds of sites to 1,000 sites, and they invested in people, processes, and tools to learn how to do this at scale. And once they got to their 1,000 sites, to go from 1,000 to 10,000 was relatively quick. They took about 8 months to get to 10,000 sites, but they took maybe 3 years to get their first 1,000 sites. And this was basically because they invested in people, processes, and tools to scale. Once you've scaled, the next step of the journey is to innovate. Once you have a virtualized platform that lends itself to further or greater automation, as well as faster innovation to market for things like network AI or vRAN AI, and that's what we're seeing now. Verizon very publicly is talking about how they're seeing major gains from their virtualized platform in as it relates to automation.
Any words of wisdom you can share based on that experience?
Yeah, absolutely. I think start early. Although the next operator to deploy vRAN, it should be much more seamless than the Verizon experience. It still takes time for every operator to go through their own learning of people, processes, and tools to scale. And our recommendation, first and foremost, is to start early. Start early with field trials. Get exposed to the technology and get your operations teams exposed to the technology through doing stuff in the field early. Secondly, as I mentioned, there are a number of industry partners that have also learned from early deployment. Wind River, Dell are two examples. But talk to proven and established vRAN ecosystem partners. Reuse components that have been previously integrated and deployed at scale, and learn from others, learn from other operators, learn from industry experts. It will save you time. I think the other learning, this is maybe an advanced learning, but when you develop in a multi-party environment, when multiple companies are working on the same solution, it's really easy for, you know, things to go awry, assumptions to not be aligned. And it's very important to capture configurations and firmware loads, load lineups, test setups across multi-parties. So capture and maintain those configs is essential. The next one I think is for each operator to determine their own internal competence. Do they want to become an SI or do they need help to be SIs? Can they develop their own tools for scale or do they need to buy? So do an assessment of your own company capability and fill in the holes as need be. And I think the last two is, the last two learnings here is, some things are only found at scale, at cell edge over temperature. So the corner cases, which you cannot get in a lab, and, create an environment where you can, learn from scale deployments in large real life environments. And then, as I mentioned before, there are best known methods out there. Come and talk to Intel. There are best known configurations and best known methods to get the most out of the underlying hardware. And recommendation is to reuse wherever possible those best known methods.
Other than technological innovation and ecosystem diversity, financial benefit has been identified as a key advantage of virtual RAN. What are your thoughts on the topic?
Yeah, Clarence, I would say this is a, the vRAN versus traditional RAN TCO is on everyone's mind globally. And I think unanimously, most operators, when they start this discussion, they do not quantify or they forget to quantify the benefits of the underlying vRAN technology. And if you look at this slide, on the left-hand side is a traditional direct OPEX and direct CAPEX comparison between traditional RAN and virtualized RAN. And there's some green items, which means, should be cheaper, and some red items, which are, new and therefore red, and some yellow items, which are about neutral. However, on the left-hand side, you can follow best practices, and there are things that you can do to minimize costs. As an example, specify open RAN radios, ORAN compliant front hall radios. And in doing so, you can get rid of the need for a front hall gateway. Or if you use proven components, your system integration costs will be greatly reduced. But I'd like just to highlight the right-hand side of the slide, which is the summary of the benefits of the technology. With a hardware software disaggregated implementation, you can do things that traditional RAN cannot do. Workload consolidation, you can hypothetically run vRAN or VDU in conjunction with virtualized router. And in doing so, you can do box consolidation. With disaggregated hardware software, you create an environment for more software flexibility. It's easier to scale up and scale down. It's easier to introduce software into next generations of x86. You can automate that much more easily. And then in automation, you can start looking at driving real innovations around network AI into the VDU. So I think the summary from my TCO experiences is please look at not only just the direct costs associated with traditional RAN versus vRAN, but also the benefits and the capabilities of the new technology.
Any parting thoughts of this evolution that you'd like to share?
I think so. In closing points here, I'd like to make a bit of a call to the industry. And, it's the technology is here and it's ready to support performance RAN. But we need to get better at this. I believe the industry needs to drive the definition of more autonomous development across nodes, better specifications, better tools and testing to enable each component vendor to have some autonomy on their development. We need to get away from integrating all the components and then testing in quality. We need to drive quality to each node and each nodal development. The ecosystem, where possible, pre-integrate. where possible, work with your ecosystem partners and integrate solutions as opposed to leaving it up to the operators. In addition to that, find better ways to communicate. Find better ways to communicate assumptions and configurations and test setups across multiple development teams. Operators, again, start early. And the recommendation is, don't wake up in 2025 and say, I want to introduce vRAN. If you want to introduce vRAN in 2025, start now. Start now by talking to industry leaders. Do your own pilot. Get your operations team exposed to the processes and new technology, and start developing early on tools. And then lastly, the OSV and ISV community, this is different. Coding and developing in a x86 environment or cloud native environment is a little bit different. You have an opportunity to be simple and to be scale and to automate more so than you were on traditional RAN, and look for telco cloud best practices and make sure you drive them into your development practices.
Well, Matt, thank you very much for your insights today.
Thank you. Thank you, Clarence. Thanks for your time.